I struggled for a long while with managing UI panels in my project. Those UI elements that you see in mostly every game, especially UI-dependent games. Whether it's a pause menu, a confirmation pop-up, or a dialog screen. They easily got my code messed up, with references to widgets thrown everywhere. The problem was, if I needed, for example, to show a dialog pop-up when the player interacts with something and hide other panels, I did that by letting my dialog widget reference all of these other widgets, whether directly or through a master widget. But what if I decided later on to change or remove one of these? You can clearly see how many things will break, how many code duplications will be there, and how the system quickly becomes a total mess. So, I started looking at different resources that helped me understand how a modular and decoupled panels manager system can be made. After a little research, I came across a Unity blog post describing a different architecture. And when contradicting it with Lyra's UI system, which I was studying at the time, I found great similarities between both of them. So, today we'll be making a little UI system inspired from these two resources. Our goal is a system that allows us to add and remove widgets from the viewport easily, making sure they show up in the right order and that their creation and removal is handled easily. We'll start with a high-level overview of the system, understanding some terminology and its different components, then we'll start implementation and end up by showing the system in action. So, without further ado, let's get started. The system has two main parts, layers and screens. We'll stick to those names, but you can name them whatever you want. Screens are the different UI widgets we have. For example, this inventory panel, this dialog model, and this game HUD are all screens. Layers, on the other hand, can be thought of as empty pages that screens can get added to. They arrange and manage the order of these screens with a data structure, often a queue or a stack. In our example, we'll use a stack, so only the last added screen will be visible and what's beneath it won't be. You will have multiple layers to contain different types of screens. For example, a menu layer to contain our pause menu and settings menu, a model layer to contain confirmation models and dialog pop-ups. You get the idea. Finally, a UI manager manages this system and allows us to register layers and easily communicate with game code. Now, enough of me talking, let's jump to the editor and start implementation. We'll start with the layer class. We'll create a new user widget and add an empty border to it, which our screens will be added to. We are using a border as it accepts only one child at a time, and we want to show one screen at a time. Let's go to the graph and add our stack of widgets. This is a simple array of user widgets. If you are not familiar with stacks, they simply mean that the last element is always on top. In our case, it means that when we add a new screen, it goes on top of other screens instead of waiting beneath them. Let's create a function to add the screen, and similar to Lyra, we will call it pushContent. It will take a soft class reference for the user widget class we want to push. Soft references, in short, let us avoid loading the asset and everything that asset references until we ask for that. In the function, you will validate the class and load it using syncLoading for simplicity, then create a user widget object from it and add it to our stack. In a production environment, this sync loading should be turned to an async one. Next, we'll create another function to remove the last element, which is the stack's top element. Again, similar to Lyra, we'll call it popContent. It will simply check if we have any elements in the first place, then it will remove the last element. This is all we need for now, but for the system to be easier to use, let's create some helper functions that will help us later on. We'll create a function that returns the top screen. We can call it peak or get top. It has a similar implementation to the pop function, but it returns the last element instead of removing it. And let's make sure to mark it as const and pure. We'll create another two functions to hide and show the top screen, which we can call later on before pushing a new screen. For the screen class, we will keep it simple and use any user widget. But if you want screens to have any logic when they are shown or hidden, for example, playing animation or sound, then it's better to make a class for them. In Lyra, the common activatable widgets are used for screens. Now, the final piece of the puzzle is where these layers are created. The answer is we will create a widget that will contain these layers and wrap their functions. We can call it UI layout, and if you are familiar with Lyra, it is similar to the primary game layout class. Before we add our layers, let's understand why would we need multiple layers in the first place. There are two reasons for this. The first is that since we set up our layers to show only the top screen, sometimes we need to see multiple screens at the same time. For example, if we are quitting the game, we need a confirmation model to show up on top of the pause menu without hiding the pause menu. We can't do that with one layer. The second reason is that it is easier to maintain when each layer handles a specific type of screens. For example, a layer that handles models and pop-ups, a layer to handle game UI, and a layer to handle menus. Now let's get back to implementation. We will add a variable to store the layers. This will be a map of gameplay tags and layer widgets. We use gameplay tags instead of names here because they are less error prone and have many benefits, which I recommend you looking into. Let's not forget to make our map variable private as well to keep everything under control. Then we'll create two functions to register and unregister layers. Register layer will take the layer tag and layer widget and add them to the map. Unregister layer will take the tag and remove it from the map if it exists. Now we'll create some wrapper functions for the layers. Push content to layer is a function that simply finds the layer that has a specific tag and call its push content function. And pop content to layer will do something similar. Let's go to the designer and add an overlay to contain our layers. I'll create four layers, but you are free to create what you think your project needs. Similar to Lyra, we'll have game, game menu, menu, and model layer. Back to the event graph, in construct event, you will register the layers with their specific tags that we can add here or through the project settings. Now let's implement the UI manager that will create our layer widget and act as an interface with the game code. The most appropriate class this manager should be is a game instance subsystem. But for simplicity, and to avoid any overhead with subsystems, we will use the HUD class to be our UI manager instead. Let's create a child from the HUD class and add it to our game mode. In its begin play, we will create the UI layout widget, cache it, and add it to our viewport. Then, we will create some wrappers for the layout widget functions, for the game code to use without knowing anything about our layers or screens or how this system works. I took this a step further and created a blueprint function library that wraps the HUD's functions for easier access, to avoid casting to the HUD class. But if you use the subsystem, this would totally be unnecessary. Now everything is in place, but if we run the game, our layers are empty. Let's see how we can use this system in action. I've created a couple of widgets here, a game screen to be pushed to the game layer, an inventory and quest screen to be pushed to the game menu layer, a confirmation and dialog models to be pushed to the model layer, and the main menu and the pause menu to be pushed to our menu layer. So, one important question is, when and where in our game code should we push screens to layers? What I believe is a good answer, and I explain that in more detail in my UI best practices video, is for screens that persist throughout the game and are shown frequently, for example our inventory and quest screens or our game menus in general, it's better for optimization to keep them in one screen and push it once the game starts. The HUD's begin play function in our example is a perfect place for those. And for models or pop-ups that are not frequently shown, we can push them when needed and pop them again after interaction. For this example, I created a component that adds a model upon overlapping with its owner and removes it when we end overlapping with it. I've also created a little debug menu that shows the layers stack at runtime. This will be included in the project files down in the description. This was it for today. We made a fairly simple system that you can improve on. Maybe use a subsystem instead of the HUD class, or turn sync loading into an async one, or add an option to use a queue instead of a stack, or make a custom widget for screens. The most important thing to get out of this video is Making time to create such reusable systems can make your life easier in your future projects. If you are interested in how Lyra's UI system works, how it makes use of subsystems and the game features plugin, let me know in the comments below. This was Amr, and as always, thank you for making it to the end of this video.